Hi, this is Tony Preckwinkle. It's Racial Equity Week. And we're here at the Brave Space Alliance in Hyde Park, which is a trans-led, black-led organization, with Lasaya Wade, who's founder and executive director, and Stephanie Scora, who's associate executive director. Did I get that right?
Yes.
Okay. All right, I'm going to let the two of you talk about this organization. We'll begin with Lasaya.
So Brave Space Alliance started over 5 years ago. Well, we're going within our next 5 years. In March, we'll hit 5 years. Brave Space grew out of a march for transgender nonconforming people, where we lost 4 trans people in a matter of a 3-month span here in Chicago.
Lost them by which you
they
mean?
Were murdered.
Right.
Here in Chicago.
No euphemisms. They were murdered.
They were murdered.
Okay, thank you.
They were murdered here in Chicago, and we didn't know what exactly we needed to do or what we should do. So the first thing as organizers, we hit the streets. And we figured out, bringing people together, there was a black hole here in Chicago where transgender nonconforming people did not have the power structure to be able to say what they wanted or what they need in this, any space where there was LGBT people fighting for their rights in any type of mode in not-for-profit here in Chicago. So out of that particular march, we had over 3,500 people on the ground. We announced that we are starting our own organization and what it looked like to actually bring the power back within the transgender nonconforming population, explicitly the BIPOC, black and indigenous brown people population here in the south and west side of Chicago.
Okay. Mm-hmm. What kind of services do you provide to the community?
So we do a little bit of everything. We have a number of programs that are centered around one of our founding philosophies of mutual aid. We do 4 mutual aid groups centered around HIV prevention and also addressing needs in the community around safer sex work, housing and financial insecurity, food insecurity, and employment justice. We also have a number of really amazing services here. We have our den and our makeup room, which are gender-affirming spaces where members of our community can come and get supplies and clothing and other gear that they need to exist as their true selves. We're working on finalizing arrangements to actually become the first nonprofit in the country to offer laser hair removal services. And we're going through a second renovation in December to put in a computer lab and a fully functional, soundproofed, state-of-the-art media room. We also have the Brave Space Alliance Crisis Pantry, which was founded as a response to the pandemic and really has just exploded and grown exponentially over the last 18 months. We've served over 300,000 people citywide and countywide, actually, with the food pantry last year. It's become a permanent part of our organization, not just an emergency program. And we're really, really glad to be able to do food systems work and address food insecurity, not just in LGBTQ communities on the South and West Side, but in black and brown communities that are living in food deserts as well.
And also including, we have free therapy for LGBT people that need to talk to someone, as well as our support groups that range from trans women support groups all the way to lesbian to gay man support groups also that starts next year.
Okay, so this organization supports the LGBTQ community broadly, but mm-hmm. specifically the trans community.
We center the lives of transgender nonconforming people, yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let me talk about a difficult subject. There are lots of organizations that focus on health and wellness, that provide food support. There are not a lot of organizations that support sex workers. Why don't you talk about that?
One of the really important things about Brave Space Alliance is at our founding, we decided we needed to support sex workers like no other organization that's not explicitly founded by sex workers in Chicago. And the reason for that is that if you look at the history of LGBTQ rights movements and trans movements in particular, at the front of those movements have always been sex workers. Marsha P. Johnson and Sylvia Rivera, who were two of the heroes of the Stonewall riots, both of them were sex workers. There have been sex workers leading our community for decades and for centuries. And you know, sex workers have always been around wherever there have been marginalized people.
As far as back in slavery, where Mary Jones actually stole $90 from her slave master to escape the sex work that her master put her up under, running to New York.
Yeah, and so we decided that it was incredibly important to be that voice for sex workers and the sex working community in the LGBTQ sphere in Chicago and in the state of Illinois. Because folks aren't sticking up for that community, and sex workers are a huge part of the work that we do in the community that we serve, and we decided that we need to be that voice when other organizations are afraid to stand up and speak up.
Right.
That is a hard space to occupy.
Mm-hmm. It is. We've tried to make it easy, though.
What's ahead for the organization?
Many things. We are now a physical agent for Task Force, which is a youth organization on the west side of Chicago. We are helping them build their 20-year legacy that they've had to maneuver in a way that they can actually support their youth on their own without having other organizations come in and use their numbers in a particular way to push forward.
Explain what you mean.
So there's a lot of organizations throughout Chicago that are smaller organizations that bigger not-for-profit actually use smaller organizations for the numbers. And explicitly, let's say Task Force directly. Task Force is normally supposed to have their own budget, figure out what it looks like to have their own budget to pay their staff. In this particular notion, they don't have their own budget. Their full budget is through other big organizations using the numbers of Task Force to push their numbers so they can get more money, not actually allowing Task Force to actually build their own structure, their own base for the organization to be able to thrive on its own. So what we have done is actually move Task Force up under BSA so they can build their own structure, get their own 501c3, figure out how it looks like to file for grants, also as well as build that structure for themselves to pay their own staff themselves without having to worry about someone else's money.
What's Task Force?
Task Force is a Task Force Community Service.
Task Force Prevention and Community Services.
On the west side of Chicago is a youth-ran LGBT community-based organization that has been there for 20 plus years. Where Dr. Green? Dr. Bell started Task Force and knew out west and had the resources that they needed.
Is this Carl Bell? Or?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Where she completely built the ground bases around what it looked like to support the LGBT youth population out there. Over the years, they were not able to actually get the funding that they needed to continue to do the work that they wanted to do. In these recent years, they lost their 501c3, and we told them that they can come up under BSA in a way so they can start over again and actually build their legacy the way they needed to build their legacy.
So this is your support for young people in the community.
And also a different mechanism to actually support smaller organizations not having to worry about big organizations coming in and actually destroying what they have built with the communities that they serve.
Okay.
There's a couple of other things as well. In 2022, we're spending a lot of time and resources to finalize and purchase property for our housing program, which is scheduled to launch in January of 2023. We're privately funding every dollar of our housing program to make sure that we don't run into the pitfalls of other housing programs that take federal and state money and therefore aren't able to serve the communities that we need most. We're focusing our housing program on Black and Brown trans individuals who often get left at the back of the line for public housing programs more broadly because they get lost in the mix. And one of the things that we've found that's unfortunately true in our community is that Black and Brown trans people, in particular young Black and Brown trans people, have found themselves intentionally contracting HIV in order to get to the front of these lines because there are programs available that get you free public housing at the front of the line if you're HIV positive. But if you're not HIV positive, you have to wait in line like everybody else. And we decided to step in and say no more. Our community should never have to choose between their long-term health and whether or not they have a roof over their head. So BSA is launching our housing program. We're doing the final work to build it up and fund it in 2022. And we're hoping to open our doors in January of 2023 to actually serve community members through that housing program. And in addition to that, in June of 2022, we're going to be launching an amazing research partnership with Northwestern University called the Chicago Area Trans Survey. We're trying to do a large population level study on trans people in Cook County, the likes of which has never been done before. There are a national level population surveys of trans people, but the latest one was done in 2015. And so now that's, 6 years ago, the data is getting old, the policy recommendations are becoming less relevant, and there's never actually been a large-scale study done of trans people on a local level. We don't have high-quality data on what it looks like to be trans in Chicago or in Cook County more broadly. And because of that, we aren't able to go to organizations like the health department, to entities like the city, and say, these are our numbers, this is what we know from the science and the math of the situation, these are the resources that we need. All we have are anecdotal evidence and our own lived experience, which unfortunately aren't always enough to persuade big entities with a lot of money to invest in the community. So we said, you know what, we're gonna do it ourselves, and we are working with Northwestern University on this wonderful project. We're hoping to survey 30,000 trans individuals countywide between June 1st and September 30th of 2022. And if we hit that goal, it will be the largest study ever conducted on trans people, not just in the country, but anywhere worldwide.
All right, data always helps, right?
Yes. Data always helps.
All right, usually I begin by asking people kind of the arc of their lives, how they got to where they are. So let's start with you, Lasaya. How did you end up doing this?
I wanted to save myself. I went to college and I had a good friend named Lisa, and she taught me how to maneuver and walk into my womanhood as a black trans woman. I know my identity is secular to cis women, but I really wanted to understand who I was as a woman, what my womanhood looks like. And we were good friends. We partied, we had fun, you know, what college girls actually do, right? But in my senior year, we were supposed to both graduate that year. I could not reach my friend for 3 days. Found the reason why I could not reach my friend was murdered and left on the side of the road. And in that particular moment, I became not only toxic, I became very much so knowingly knowing what my life would look like in the future if I came out as a trans woman. That's where my activism actually...
And Lisa was a trans woman.
Huh? And Lisa was a trans woman, yes.
Okay.
And in that moment, I knew my life would never be the same as it was before her. And that's what started my activism and my advocacy after college.
The murder of a friend.
Yes.
What about you, Stephanie?
Well, my story is a little bit different. So I come from a really old Jewish family in Chicago. My family came here in the 1880s, has been in Rogers Park basically the entire time. And you know, when I went off to college, I realized that I hadn't been given the space to be my full self. I came out as a trans person, and unfortunately, I experienced a lot of rejection from my family. I was down in Champaign-Urbana. And essentially left to my own devices after my family said, you know, well, you can either be a part of our family or you can be trans. And I made the choice to be myself. And in Champaign, I sort of tried to stand on my own 2 feet and create a community in the cornfields for trans people. I helped found a number of trans organizations in Champaign-Urbana and eventually was brought into leadership of the LGBT Center for Champaign County, the Uniting Pride Center down in Champaign. My partner at the time, and I moved up to Chicago at the end of 2016, and I had already been doing activism and organizing for several years at that point. I had been a part of a lot of movements and been part of a lot of organizing work downstate, but I came up to Chicago and through a mutual friend was introduced to Lasaya, mm-hmm. And we clicked right away. We were instant friends. We had the same politics, the same beliefs, that same passion and spark for fighting for our community and creating the things that we knew needed to exist for folks like us. And so when Lasaya said that she was going to be founding an organization and needed help figuring out how to run a nonprofit, I was more than happy to at first volunteer, and then she brought me on as a member of the staff, and we've been running forward ever since.
$2 in the pocket.
Yeah, we started with $500 and a dream, and now we're here.
Stephanie, I understand that you've done some work with Commissioner Kevin Morrison on the Cook County Board of Commissioners.
Yeah, we've actually had a wonderful partnership with Commissioner Morrison and really the whole county board, mm-hmm. on helping to pass a number of trans-positive measures, including most recently that wonderful bill that was passed around eliminating gender and sex-related questions on county-level forms. And a couple of years ago, the proclamation of support for trans individuals on the county level. We're also working a little bit with Commissioner Morrison's office, and we're hoping to interface with the board as a whole around some legislation to protect trans individuals in Cook County Jail from some of the mistreatment that they've experienced there. But you know, we've had a wonderful legislative partnership with Commissioner Morrison and with Cook County as a whole, and we're proud to help make this a great place to live for our community.
All right, this is a not-for-profit organization. I presume it needs revenue.
Yes,
Lasaya, can you tell us how people can support the work?
There's multiple ways that you can support the work that we do here. You can go to bravespacealliance.org, donate. Also, we are accepting volunteers through Monday through Saturday to help support the communities that we serve. We are reaching numbers from 3,000 people a week throughout our programs that we do here at BSA. Also, you can follow us on Twitter,
Facebook,
Instagram. All of the social medias, and explicitly understanding what we're doing day by day and asking people to pretty much do. And every month or every week, we make sure if we are needing something from a community, we post it, and the community can pretty much come in and make sure that it's taken care of.
For more specifics, you can go specifically to bravespacealliance.org/donate if you want to contribute financially. Mm-hmm. On Instagram, we're at Brave Space Alliance, and on Twitter, we're at Brave Space Chai.
All right, thank you, Stephanie. Thank you, Lasaya, for joining us. And we're very grateful that you joined us as well for Talk with Tony.